EC22X here. We are on the first week of the Ray Ray Draft League. I am really, really excited. We had two stream matches that we were going to have some commentating over. But let's talk about a little bit about the rankings and changes that have been happening. So, this was our initial power ranking. Obviously, we did move, as I mentioned, the old Wildfish a little bit around 8 or 9. Because they did a very, very nice trade of actually getting the Dusclops got traded for Galarian Moltres, which I think is going to be very, very well for them. Otherwise, I think this is reflecting a lot of what I think is going to happen. The matches actually ended up pretty fast, so I was very happy to see them and the results. I think there was a big upset that I probably didn't think to see coming. So let's talk a little bit about the results that happened. One of the upset matches that happened was actually the Corviknight Knights versus the new Bar Cloud Puppies. We do have them both ranked very similarly, like 3 and 4, right? Diamond, who is the Corviknight Knights manager, actually was part of season 1, had a very close run, a little tough at the start, but now he's in High Roller practicing too. And then, as I mentioned, 45 Mice from the from the Loud Puppies. He's a veteran BGC player, really, really well. They ended up being in a close set of 3. So really, I was favoring 45, but good job on Diamond to actually beating such a good player. Another surprisingly, I did think it had to do a little bit with prep, but there was another upset, which was the between Alolan Aegislash and the California Crotons. California Crotons, managed by Johnny, actually ended up 2-0-ing Alolan Aegislash, aka Sven. So this match actually was the last one of the week, and I do think the Sven was just not as well prepared as he wished he was. Just got a little run over, my little minor mistake, so that was very, very unfortunate. But yeah, and I think another really cool match that unfortunately this did happen in Showdown, it's not as easy to commentate in Showdown matches, but another really cool one was actually the old Wildfish match. This was, I believe he had got KJ? I do believe it was KJ. And then Tortornator was a big man for the old Wildfish. Joke, big shout outs to them for doing so great. As I mentioned, I know very little about their draft experience, but I know they're an amazing BGC player. And Tortornator it was one of the best 25 points picks out there. A lot of people were upset because they also had their eyes, but Joke just like, I'm just going to grab it now. So really, really cool about that. We also had a couple other trades happening. Ducky from the Feisty Scrafties actually did their last two trades that they could do. So they actually won't have any more trades for the rest of the season. We actually limit them to 3 trades per day. So they actually traded, I believe, let me double check our sheet. Ducky traded their Weavile for Blaziken. Oh, actually looks like my sheet is a little bit wrong here. But they do have a Blaziken now, which I'm very, very happy. I love Blaziken. And they did do the Assume. They were a little behind, but I think the Assumeral trade did happen. So the Gyarados was traded for Assumeral. The Salazzle was traded for Weavile. And then the Drifloon got traded for the Blaziken, I'm pretty sure. But I will double check that. The sheet is a little bit wrong, I think. And I can't show the Discord. Another cool trade was Jackie. Jackie ended up trading Scrafty and Jackie ended up getting Scrafty and Tornado's Tyrion after our recommendation from the power recap drafting first video we did. I think I'm really excited to see it. Although they did take their L in the week 1, I think these changes will make their team stronger in general. And then 45 Mice also actually did surprisingly very interesting trades. Maractus for Cradilli, and then they got Butterfree for Vanilluxe. So I'm a little sad because I thought Butterfree was going to be pretty clutch. Rage Powder, like G-Max, Beautiful, whatever the move, I can't even say it correctly. But and then so another surprise and very sad trade that I saw was Jokay trading Appleton for Lycanroc Dusk. I'm not sure how that will go through, to be quite honest, but we'll see. Now let's go to our future matches.
Hello everyone, my name is Grayson DeWolf, joined by Izzy, as we are commentating the Ray Ray Draft League, week one, this exciting match of KD versus Ally.
Yeah, Ally is actually our season one champion, while KD is a veteran draft player. I believe he has done a couple ones, including the High Roller Draft League, which we based a lot of our rules and tiers mons on it. So this is actually pretty exciting. I actually rank both teams pretty average on our power ranking just because of a couple of pieces. I believe we did give Ally the edge, but one funny thing is that I also Ally and our friends, and I said that I didn't like the Copperaya. I personally have used it before and it felt very mid. So I feel like he purposely brought it kind of to like show me, hey, easy. You know, get ready to see the power of Copperaya. So I'm excited to see it play.
Yeah, I'm excited to see all these mons be played. We with these draft leagues, it's exciting to get to use mons that we have not normally been used. So hopefully I won't fumble on any of these mons we haven't seen in a while. But it's really exciting to see what is happening. I will say when I look at KD's team, there's not a lot of offensive pieces. A lot of supportive mons that we in the past we have seen be kind of like helping side support pieces are kind of all over their team. So I'm excited to see if they have enough pressure to do enough damage to a lot of the more offensive pieces over on Ally side. We do see a Frostlass and a Tapu Lele come out from KD's side as a Togekiss and an Alolan Exeggutor on Ally side here.
Yeah, and Frisk reveals this choice scarf on that Tapu Lele and a sash on Frostlass. So this is actually really good information in general for Ally. But the one thing is, if you guys notice in the preview, is that the Exeggutor does have a Rosaline berry. And this shoe actually, maybe depending on what the Frostlass plays, could just let this TR get set up.
Yeah, I do believe that we have some spread move options over on KD's side. Curious to see if, yeah, and sure enough, we see an Icy would come out. That is going to lower the speed of both these Pokemon, and if Exeggutor is able to live to the end of this turn, it might be beneficial dropping in speed if they're able to get Trick Him Up. We'll have to see what this Tapu Lele goes for. It might be able enough to take up the knockout, but we do see that berry be activated, going to be lowering the damage output of this Fairy-type move, and it is going to survive a very clutch survival, because now we do see a Trick Room going up, and now I believe Allies got everything they wanted out of this turn.
Absolutely. And now Allies knows the Tapu Lele scarf, and they click Dazzling Gleam, so they're locking this Dazzling Gleam. And not only is it the fastest mon, it's gonna be the last mon to run because of TR now, and because of, you know, if the Togekiss was a little bit faster, the Icy Wind just guaranteed that is now the next slowest thing around in this. So the Icy Wind, I think, backfired a little, and right now I think we could see a double knockout, or at least potentially the Frostlass going down, depending on what Ally decided to do.
Yeah, absolutely. And I do think that I wonder if this Draco Meteor that we just saw, the targeted in the Frostlass, will even be enough to go down to the Focus Sash. But it certainly should be enough for that Dazzling Gleam to take up the knockout if they don't go for a Protect. We do see Draco Meteor come out. Let's see how much this does. It does connect. And we're going to see bring it down almost to the Sash, but it's not as special attack. It's going to be lowered by two stages, making Exeggutor quite lose a lot of its offensive pressure. But this Dazzling Gleam is going to pick it up just in time for the Dazzling Gleam to be disabled, which is kind of exciting. Won't be able to use that move anymore until it's swapped out, as another Dazzling Gleam is traded back, and that is going to pick up the KO on the Exeggutor.
Yeah, one for one, but I do believe that Ally has this a slight advantage because right now, Copper Raya can just come in freely. Iron Head, Rock Slide, Power Whip, three really strong moves. Iron Head could probably just one hit KO the Tapu Lele, depending on what KD brought in the back. The other two moves probably will. I don't think the grass will probably covers anything that he brought, but if there's a Cinderace or Zapdos, yeah, okay, yeah. I think Copper Raya covered for two of the other Dynamax options that they had, and this is actually looking very, very scary.
Yeah, I think that you can easily go for the rock move into Cinderace, and the Cinderace isn't even able to use Sucker Punch here and change its typing to avoid getting that super effective damage because of the second train being up. So I think there's not really a great way for Cinderace to deal with it. Obviously, I don't think Katie necessarily knows that there's a rock move on this Cooperaya, but it certainly is an option here. And I'm curious to know if this Max Rockfall will be able to knock out the Cinderace. I think even if a helping hand is in play, I wonder if the Cinderace will be able to live on just barely enough, and then maybe a Max Pyro Ball, Max Fire move will be able to deal enough damage to this Cooperaya to the point where the other pieces of the team can knock it out. Otherwise, I don't see anything stopping this Cooperaya from just sweeping the entire team with how much Trick Room turns are still in play.
Absolutely. And do we do see KD actually going for the Dynamax? I believe that's probably be going to the Cinderace. And it just depends whether or not this picks up the KO. If it's on Cinderace can survive this, it will be, KD will turn the game around. However, things are not looking good in my opinion.
Yeah, we'll have to see how much this Max Rockfall does. We do see the helping hand come out. That is certainly going to help out with the damage output against it. And we do see this Protect coming out, maybe reading that that Ally would target into that instead. So I would imagine Ally is feeling quite happy to see that Protect come out as this Max Rockfall comes in. And then, oh my word, it is enough to do a clean knockout. That is so huge, the Cinderace. And it was a critical hit. Oh my word, that is tough news if you are KD.
Yes, and actually, I think we made a mistake early. Maybe we read the choice scarf on the Froslass because if and not on the Tapu Lele, because Tapu Lele just protected, and if it was
Oh,
choice scarf, it would have.
that is
So
true.
I apologize for that. The text goes really fast, so but I think that's what happened, which very, that makes sense why the Froslass got knocked out. But yes, the critical hit, I do not believe it matter. So much because the helping hand was there to cover for it, and I think that was enough, but very unfortunate regardless because I believe it's a calc like you would like to know just in case, you know, as I do this is enough, and right now this is looking very dire. If I was Katie, maybe I try to fish some information, see if I can hit KO the Togekiss and see what's in the bag. But I'm surprised if Chinchito was your last one, maybe you should have brought it before and tried to stall some max turns or something. Very tough decision
Yeah.
though.
Yeah, I'm not really sure. I think that there's nothing stopping this Cooperaya from just going through and KOing either of these Pokemon. There's not, like you said, very odd to see such a supportive mon be in the back without really any offensive abilities to stand up for itself against, a Dynamax Pokemon that still has two Dynamax turns left. So I'm really curious to see what the game two adjustment is. There is so many. I think Zapdos and Cinderace are probably the pieces that you have as Dynamax like choices. Otherwise, there's really not a whole lot of offensive pressure really being put on by KD's team, especially when we have so many offensive pieces here. I think that we haven't seen the Gengar be used yet, but that we I would imagine be putting a lot of damage out. You got to worry about the Landorus as well. And so I'm really curious to see if there's any way to mitigate that damage or be able to go on the offense if you're KD.
Absolutely. And honestly, this is a very, very rough matchup for KD. Lando and Cooperaya alone beat Zapdos and Cinderace respectively. Then like Froslass, Chinchito, Meowstic, they're just kind of supporting Mon. They can't do much. I and it's gonna be very, very rough. I think the fact that hopefully that Meowstic has maybe Fake Out or some other, I believe he also gets Fake Tears and maybe Reflect. So hopefully that might be a mon that KD could try and adjust, but otherwise it's really, really rough. Looking at the monsters, you have to force ally potentially to, turn to Dynamax at the same time as you, if anything. But the moment you give a little too much of a leeway to ally's team, you're kind of like, it's kind of scary. Mostly because even though ally is actually swapping its lead, doing the same lead it did turn one, it's not bad. Like going back for the TR turn one is still pretty viable because you still like Executor. You saw the moves that Executor and Togekiss each have. They have a lot of possible options besides just follow me TR. Like you could yawn and stuff like
Yeah.
that. So very interesting if this lead that Will did, I mean I will actually help out.
Yeah, I think it's nice when you're a game ahead. You can kind of predict your opponent might be adjusting for your hard Trick Room lead that worked the first time, and so you can respond to that by leading something different. And we do see potentially an adjustment over on KD's side that might stop that, but I'm curious to know how they feel about seeing this Landorus coming out on ally side, as ally 2 has made a very big adjustment.
I think Katie was reading the TR game, but unfortunately this was a little too passive, especially as we can see that Ally is actually thinking about Dynamaxing, and I think this is huge. While I did mention that you wanna force Ally to Dynamax first, I think if he picks the KO here potentially might look a little bit bad for you because the kiss is gonna hurt, and yeah, they're doubling to Tapu Lele because it is a Sash Lele, and it was
Yeah.
really fast. So I do believe the land is still faster, but I'm not sure if this is the wisest thing to do
I'm a
for.
little shocked to see that Landorus did come out, because if KD did lead Froslass again, I don't think there's anything stopping Froslass from going for an Icy Wind, or maybe even maxing and doing huge damage into Landorus. And even with a Togekiss, the Follow Me wouldn't stop from the Icy Wind hitting this Landorus. So I think it's a huge read to be able to just, no, I don't think you're gonna bring that Froslass. I'm gonna bring my Landorus, and I'm gonna do huge damage with this Max Airstream, boosting up my speed, and I'm gonna completely change the mode of my team, which I think just going for a straight offensive heavy hard-hitting strategy here is huge, and that Tapu Lele is gone. Ooh, another crit. A lot of crits this set. I'm not sure if that critical hit actually mattered. It was pretty close. And we're just gonna see an expanding force coming here, just doing a little bit of chip damage to both Mons. But I think that Katie needs a different strategy here in order to deal with this Landorus, and this Zapdos might be what it needs.
Yeah, and actually, fun fact is that both of these Pokemons actually are flying from Ally's app. You could, if the Miastic had Fake Out, you could have, unless I remember right, but you could have faked out the Togekiss too. Unless Miastic doesn't get it. I swear I thought it did. And otherwise, yeah, this is actually still very dicey for KD. You want the Ally to Dynamax early, but because you started with such a passive lead, you need to now call out, is there gonna be a follow me? Like, cause the Togekiss is absolutely annoying, and I don't know if that Zapdos can KO the Landorus, because the Landorus could easily just KO the Zapdos back. So it'll be very
Yeah.
interesting to see what's gonna happen.
Yeah, and Landorus has a choice here. We see that they have Max Quake as well as Max Airstream and Max Rockfall, which is super effective against the Zapdos. So you kind of have a choice if you want to chip down the Zapdos, or if you want to just kind of boost your defenses and kind of prepare for weathering the storm, since this Dynamax Zapdos is a turn behind for the Dynamax. We do see this Reflect come out, which is very fascinating. We're able to see that this is an Earth Power, so this is a special attacking Max Quake. Not going to care about that Reflect too much, as the special attack is going to be, or special defense is going to be boosted on this side. It's not enough to KO the Meowstic, but it's certainly going to bring it down to maybe being in Dazzling Gleam Chip, depending on if it's able to pick up the KO or not. It'll be pretty close as Max Airstream comes out, and oh my word, that actually does so much damage. I wonder if that's a life orb. No, another critical hit.
The game of crits, man. The game, because that special defense that the Lando got was huge.
Oh.
Oh, and Yon gets revealed. So this is actually a little bit unfortunate. Not picking the KO and again Yon. But there was no life orb reveal on the Zapdos. So
No.
could be a Lone Berry. Hopefully We'll see.
You can fingers crossed. I think your fingers crossed that it's not a Lumberry if you're an ally here. And I think if you're KD, I think you have to just acknowledge the fact that Zapdos is going to be taking a nap after this next turn. So maybe you just target down to the Togekiss, try to remove it from the field, or the Landorus. I think you have your pick of the two, and just deciding which one needs to be gone. Of course, you're kind of worried of potentially a Follow Me, so maybe it's the safest move to just max Lightning into Togekiss. But then again, if you can go for a max Airstream into Landorus if you don't think a Follow Me is going to come out, and then you can try to go for a KO. We do see Helping Hand here, so I'm curious to see what they chose to do. It is the max Lightning. With this Helping Hand, it's certainly going to be enough to get the KO on this Togekiss, and is going down. Togekiss is gone, but I think Landorus is going to be able to retaliate and maybe take up a KO on Meowstic, or do a decent chunk of chip to this the Zapdos before it takes a nap. But you might not really need to chip it down that whole much, considering that's going to be falling asleep this next turn.
Yeah, and then we do get a Nokanor knockout. Bye-bye, Meowstic. I mean, it did its job. It's very unfortunate that Meowstic seemed to, again, very supportive. And then, unfortunately, the Zapdos is falling asleep. No Lumberry reveal. Still 3 months left for... I mean, 2 extra months left for Katie, for Ally. And Katie just up to this last month. So this is actually getting dicey. There is a chance that, you know, we could get lucky and Katie gets a one-turn wake-up. But
I'm just laughing at the nickname Pyro Butt. Over on, I'm not sure if that is another language or if that is a nickname, but that is hilarious. That's a hilarious name for a Cinderace, regardless. But we do see a Trick Room being one of the tools in Gengar's toolbox. I think that's really fascinating and might have been something that was prepped just for this game, but probably just prepping for the Cooperaya in the back. But we do see the Sucker Punch coming through, and that'll certainly be enough to knock out this Landorus. Gonna be making sure that not a whole lot of offensive pressure is happening, at least for this turn in the set. And we do see that one turn required sleep happening over on Zapdos as Trick Room comes up. And I think if you're KD, you might be expecting what's happening next.
Yeah, so I believe that now, you know, we are hoping, like, can you wake up Zapdos? Because if it doesn't, I think this game is pretty much over. Because even if, like, right now, you have the Gengar is Sash. So even you Sucker Punch the Gengar thinking the Gengar is going to tap this turn, you're still going to die potentially because you a crit Sucker Punch is not going to be even enough to even, like, KO the copper.
So. Yeah, I think what you really need to be doing is probably be doubling into the Cooperaya. I guess if a Pyro Ball might be enough to knock it out, or if not, it certainly would put it in range for a Thunderbolt. So I think you maybe have to hope that Cinderace is able to live maybe a Rock Slide here, not get flinched, be able to fire off the Pyro Ball, and if it doesn't pick up the KO, hopefully that the Zapdos will be able to finish it off, because Gengar probably is just doing some chip damage. I expect it's going to be doing quite a bit of damage, but maybe not as much offensive pressure as this Cabrera is putting off. We do see Sucker Punch that does do so much damage with that Life Orb as Rock Slide comes off. It does not miss. It connects on both targets. Going to be doing so much damage onto that Cinderace. And here's another crit. Oh, my word. But we see a weakness policy over on the Zapdos. If it wakes up this turn, that might mean some really... Oh, we do see Sludge Bob coming through. And it is enough. So the Zapdos isn't even given the chance to wake up as we see this Cinderace just clinging on to life in these final turns of this game.
Yeah, that was very unfortunate. Because there was a slightly way for, as I mentioned, a small way for Katie to win, right? Missed the Rock Slide. So your Cinder Sucker Punch it could maybe crit it the second time, the copper. And it's still pretty tough, but I do think Ally, the more I look at it, had a very favorable matchup, but KD brought it a little bit closer to this one, and I really like the adaptations from both sides because of it.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that it's tough because my opinion, but looking at these two draft teams, I would say that KD's draft picks are a bit less offensive. There's not a whole lot of pieces there, at least in the six that we saw in the set. there's not as many pieces there that can really stand up to the onslaught of a more offensive team. And we did see that Ally had a lot of offensive pieces. They had Grimmsnarl and they had Togekiss, but the rest of those Mons were all things that could Dynamax, were all things that could dish out a lot of damage. And so when you have three or four Pokemon on your team that typically are just there for helping hands, for fake outs, for trick rooms, for, you know, chip damage, it's really hard to go up against Ally's team. So I think it was a really, really exciting match just to get to see some Mons we haven't seen in a while and see some fun strategies. I always really enjoy seeing a trick room team built around Exeggutor being the one setting it, just because we don't get to see it a whole lot. And certainly the Cooperaya putting in so much work and just kind of being like the checkmate piece for Ally's team against against your previous opinions, Izzy. Do you still have that opinion that Cooperaya is not great?
I think it just got lucky with the matchup.
So, to be fair, I don't think I've seen a set with that many crits in a very long time. That's the rolls on in that set. I would love to do the math at some point and just see where the chances for that. But it's moments like that that make these sets and the game of VGC so much fun to watch sometimes.
Absolutely. All right, guys. So this will be the match we feature now. We have a second match that will come out later on in the week. But I hope you guys enjoyed the recap. And Grayson, thank you for coming and commentating with me. Until next time, guys. Bye.
Bye, everyone. Hello, everyone. My name is Grayson DeWolf, joined by Angelo Hunter, and we're excited to bring you a cast of the Ray Ray Draft League, week one of our very own Angelo Hunter versus Ducky VGC.
Yeah, hey, guys. I played this match this week. Very excited to take you through my thoughts and the action in this very exciting week one battle.
It has not been spoiled for me. I don't know anything about it. So I will be coming at this as a very outsider, unsubjective person, just enjoying the set and giving some insight. And as we go, maybe if we can get a direct look into the mind of Angelo Hunter, one of the players that we'll be following through this set. And I'm very excited to see what you have to say about your decisions. And I'll also try to do my best to look and see what Ducky had going on for them. So, all right, let's get into it.
Yeah, let's get started.
And this is a draft league, so that means that we're going to be seeing a lot of Pokemon here that we do not see regularly. So I have no idea actually what you have on your draft team or on Ducky's, of course, either. So really excited to see what you pulled there. Did you have any strategy based around your draft?
Yeah, so their team going in is much faster than mine. And one of my main options in terms of offense and Dynamax is Celesteela. So my game plan really revolves around Dynamaxing Celesteela and sort of making sure it can do enough damage and stick around long enough for the end game. So interested to see what you think of the teams here.
Yeah, this is super fun. I especially am loving to see that Lumberry Garchomp, a huge offensive presence. Mimikyu is so versatile, especially in a draft league. I feel like you can really use it for a lot of needs depending on what the opponent brings. I can see you on your Twitch cam writing down their Pokemon that they decided to bring. Were there any surprises here as you looked and saw Ducky's team?
You know, I honestly didn't think they were going to bring Rillaboom this week just because Celesteela and Volcarona themselves sort of wall it. But they recently, before this game, they traded a Gyarados in favor of the Azumarill. So I kind of knew the Azumarill was coming and I had to sort of readjust my game plan in order to account for that. As you'll see, I have a poison memory on the Silvally, so I have access to a very strong poison attack that can one shot an Azumarill. That's basically what that's for.
Fascinating.
I was also a bit surprised to see that they brought Cobalion, and I kind of assumed that the Salazzle was there to use beat up on it. And that was something that I didn't exactly game plan for, so I wasn't exactly confident against it if it would be able to, you know, kind of steamroll my entire team, because you would think Celesteela is enough to hold up to that, but I wasn't too sure going into it.
Well, really exciting to see what they decide to lead. That both of these teams, you know, are so random and so unconventional that it's really anyone's guess as to what the leads are going to be and what the game plan is going to be, especially with some mons that we haven't seen in a long time after playing in a restricted format. We're going to see that shiny Azumarill come out as next to a Thundurus. Curious to know if the Thundurus is if it is offensive or a supportive Thundurus, especially when we have the your Manectric on the field. I would imagine that you're feeling pretty good, assuming that you don't have to worry about even eerie impulses onto your Celesteela.
Yeah, and that was kind of my strategy going into it, was to figure out what kind of Thundurus they were using. I was still kind of concerned about an Azumarill max and something like proccing a policy on Azumarill. So I was playing a bit passive here, and I decided to just click Volt Switch here and protect my Celesteela. But I also thought, you know, maybe they're big brain and they expect something like a Volt Switch and they still go for the Eerie Impulse. I know that doesn't really make sense if they're Prankster, but I was kind of overthinking this turn and just decided to play it safe.
And we do see the Dynamax Azumarill come off. That's massive. I'm also curious to know if it's a Belly Drum set in case for game two or game three, if there is a chance of it being Belly Drum, because that's always a really scary thing to see in Azumarill. We do see the Protect come out from Celesteela, playing very defensive, maybe just looking to see what this Thundurus is going to do. As a Scary Face comes out, going to be lowering the speed of the Manectric, and Azumarill is going to do whatever it wants right here. Oh no, Volt Switch, you're still faster. That is a very slow Azumarill. Volt Switch does only a bit of a chunk to this Azumarill. It's very beefy, and we have the option of going into Mimikyu or the Volcarona here. Big decision here, because I would imagine you would feel maybe okay dropping the disguise on Mimikyu in exchange for wasting a Dynamax turn, but also you might enjoy keeping that around in the future as well.
Yeah, so here I kind of had to make the decision you just talked about. I was deciding whether I was okay with Mimikyu losing its disguise or just taking down Volcarona down to its Sash. I was basically debating which Mon would be more important in the endgame, and I figured that Rillaboom might be in the back, so I ended up swapping into Mimikyu here. It was interesting to see Scary Face on their end. It was actually a really good bring because they respected the Manectric but still wanted speed control on their Prankster Thundurus. And you'll see that my Manectric was still faster because I actually had the Choice Scarf on it.
Sure. And that is, kind of brings in some mind games here, because with Mimikyu, I would imagine that Max Geyser on this Mimikyu is now going to knock it out. But if you were to keep it there, there's also a chance that you can set up Trick Room, especially knowing that, well, I guess you maybe wouldn't want to do that considering they have Scary Face. They can just Scary Face themselves, and Azumarill is probably the slowest thing on the field here. I think Celesteela is probably the best piece here, but I think you need to find a way to mitigate this Azumarill's damage output, because right now it's putting on so much pressure.
Yeah, and I was thinking the exact same thing that you just said. I kind of want Trick Room up, but I kind of don't. Luckily, I have Will-O-Wisp on my Mimikyu, so I figured I can get up a Rock Fall here and maybe live something like a Max Geyser from the Azumarill. Maybe a bit hopeful on my end, considering that thing's probably huge power. Right. But I decided to go to get as much damage off on the Thundurus with the Rock Fall and try to burn the Azumarill, because I am in threat of an Eerie Impulse here. But if he decides to go for the Eerie Impulse, then I can burn the Azumarill, and then it's not too much of a threat. So I kind of put them in it. They have to make the decision here, in a sense.
Yeah, I mean, either piece is something that they don't want, right? You don't want the Thundurus to go down. You don't want the Azumarill to get burned, for sure. But the Scary Face is going to come out again, making sure that it moves slower, which I think is really fascinating. This Max Ruffles come out, and this should be able to pick up the Thundurus. Yes, there's no Sash, and that is also going to get rid of the rain, which means that this damage output from this Azumarill is going to be weakened, which might mean that if they do target down the Mimikyu, Mimikyu might be able to survive the turn. There's a small chance, but most importantly, the Beast Boost does go off. Getting that special attack boost is going to be super helpful in steamrolling with the rest of your Dynamax turns. And this Max Steel Spike comes out, and that'll certainly be enough to knock out Mimikyu. Great information to have that would potentially be... What move would that Max Steel Spike be off of? Would that just be... What would that be?
I think it would be Steel Roller. That, to my knowledge, that's the only really strong steel move that Azumarill gets. So I kind of I locked in Steel Roller there, and that kind of eliminated the possibility of me living a geyser with the weather change. So very smart move on their end. But now my Celesteela is in a pretty good position, because They're on their last turn of Dynamax, and I have a plus one Celesteela, and now I have some speed control available with Manectrican, since it's Choice Scarf, and there's with the Spectrier on the other side.
Yeah, and now that I would imagine the Spectrier is a candidate for having a Focus Sash, and so with that, if you're able to keep up the Sandstorm to the end of this turn, you might not have to worry about even double tapping into it to remove it from the field if it is Sash. There is always that chance, though, that the Azumarill goes last and then gets the rain back up, so that doesn't happen. But I think with the Scary Faces down the field, the speed tiers are going to be different. You have your own Scary Face coming from the Manectric. So much Scary Face happening here. We see Spectrier, which probably was the fastest thing on the field, now going to be significantly slower. Max Steel Spike coming out. This should do a decent chunk at plus one. Is not able to knock it out. The Sand Chip won't be enough to KO it, and it will be lasting for the rest of this turn.
Yeah, I think my change last minute to make Celesteela a timid nature kind of didn't pay off there. And my calx right before that Steel Spike looked like it was going to be close. Yeah, they actually go for a Geyser into Manectric here. And it does a good chunk, as you can see, with the critical hit. I believe with this follow-up, yeah, I believe there's a Snarl following up. And that would have just KO'd the Manectric anyway. So that crit wasn't actually too impactful, even with the Steel Spike boost.
A fantastic choice from Ducky's side of the field to not only knock out the Manectric, which was pretty much the most of the speed control that you had on your side, but also, most importantly, slowing down that Celesteela, I think, is really important, because now you're back to neutral, and it's still doing a lot of damage, but not as much as you'd like to do. I'd imagine you can still follow up and try to get the KO on the Spectrier and get that boost back up again and try to keep the momentum in your favor, but your Dynamax is ending at the end of this turn, so I think this is a big turn to make sure that you can keep the momentum in your favor now that Azumarill is small.
Yeah, exactly. And the Spectrier is not faster than my Celesteela, so I have the option to just go for an Airstream. And here they actually decide to switch out into Rillaboom, which I was a little surprised of. This gives me... I did Airstream that slot, so that's going to do a lot of damage. And I did click Giga Drain with Volcarona, so the grassy terrain is certainly helping me in that aspect as well.
Oh my word. I feel like all the cards just... everything lined up in favor of you in this turn here. This is super lucky. This Max Dirtium is going to do so much Rillaboom. It is a clean knockout, easy. Now you have the speed control for the rest of this game, I'd imagine. And most importantly, you're also going to be boosting up your special attack. I'm not sure what else Ducky can do at this point. I think that turn was pivotal.
Yeah, and if you saw how little damage that Giga Drain did, even with the grassy terrain, I can pretty much guarantee at this point that the Azumarill is Assault Vest, and the Celesteela's Airstream was able to KO the Rillaboom, so that was definitely not Assault Vest. And at this point, I'm pretty confident in just Celesteela on its own to just take out the last two Mons, although the Azumarill may be a bit tricky with the Assault Vest left, but a Giga Drain plus Flash Cannon should be able to pick it up. So I'm pretty confident here about the win.
Yeah, I would imagine that if you were Ducky, I think here you're just trying to get a little more information. Fortunately, the Volcarona was not brought down. Oh no, it was brought down to Sash. It just got healed by the grassy terrain. So they know that the Volcarona has the Sash. It's nowhere else. The item has not been revealed yet on the Celesteela, so maybe just trying to hunt for whatever that is, unless it's Life Orb. Is it Life Orb on the Celesteela?
Yeah, it's actually a weakness policy. I was planning on Volt Switching myself with... Yeah, I was planning on Volt Switching myself with Manectric, but that actually didn't happen.
Super exciting. Very cool. Well, hopefully they're able to get some more information as we go into game two, but this Flash Can is going to easily pick up the KO, and I would imagine that this Azumarill only has single target moves, so it's going to be quite a big ask for Azumarill to be doing anything, and especially when I think we have a plus two Celesteela, and it's really fun seeing Celesteela being so useful. I remember Celesteela being one of my favorite things to be using back when it was viable. And especially when it's so versatile, when you see it on team preview, is it going to be the defensive leash seed set that is such a problem for so many teams? Or are you going to get kind of scared and thrown off balance by a very offensive set that's going to be, you know, doing so much damage if it gets steamrolling? So Celesteela just kind of showing how much fun it is to use it as a Celesteela player.
Yeah, and I actually had the number one overall pick in this draft, and I picked Celesteela just for the reasons you described. Because it's so bulky. You can use it offensively, you can use it defensively. Like, it's pretty much not gonna go down ever. And I've used it before successfully in draft league, so yeah, I was really excited to use it.
Again, I've never played in a draft league, but I would imagine that it's really important choosing mons that can be flexible, because there's going to be some weeks where you just have a terrible matchup and you have to get super creative. And there's so many things to do with South Steel. You can also make it physical or special offensive, if I remember correctly.
Yep.
And so the range, the coverage that Celesteela has, if you're in a pinch and you just need a super effective move on something for a super specific instance, I think Celesteela covers just so many bases. So I can understand why you'd choose that and build a team around it and a game plan around it. And it's just so much fun, especially seeing weakness policy. There wasn't a whole lot of information gained. Also, I'm not even sure if the choice scarf was necessarily revealed. I think that Spectrier never moved after Manetric, and so I think the choice scarf is still a secret as well. I'm curious to see if that comes into play here.
I think they should recognize the choice scarf, because I was able to scary face their Spectrier that one turn when I steel spiked it. They should also know it after they scary faced my Manetric. When they went for a Max Geyser with Azumarill, I believe that Azumarill is a bit on the faster side.
Sure. Well, that makes total sense. I mean, the speed tier of Azumarill is so interesting just because it is a bit slower, and a lot of people have paired it with Trick Room. But when it's paired with Trick Room, it is pretty fast compared to a lot of other Trick Room mons. And so it is kind of in an awkward place with speed tiers. And I think that's one of the biggest disadvantages of it. But of course, if you're able to get a Belly Drum off, I think, you know, if you can just Aqua Jet the entire time, and then you don't really care about how fast you are. But really curious to see what happens here for as far as adjustments. I didn't see what you typed in for your lead, and so I'm really curious to see if there were any adjustments on your end, if you felt kind of comfortable with what you did. And I'm curious to see if Ducky, if they change up what they had. And they do. We see a Rillaboom and a Spectrier on that side. That's a very different game plan than last time. And we do see a slightly different variation over on your side with the Mimikyu coming out as well as the Celesteela.
Yeah, so my plan going into this game too was to lead Celesteela and Mimikyu, hoping they would lead something similar. And I would either, like, their option was let Celesteela do a ton of damage or let Trick Room go up. Because I figured they might not bring Azumarill in this game, because it didn't, although it did a lot of damage, it didn't like put on a ton of pressure last game. But now facing the Rillaboom and the Spectrier, I'm thinking, oh no, he's going to max the Rillaboom and KO me through Disguise and click Snarl, and I'm just going to have absolutely nothing to do here.
I think that's a genius play.
Yeah, so
that's what Ducky goes for.
So going into this game, the only way they could really stop Trick Room was basically by doing that, or by double attacking the Mimikyu with something really strong. So I definitely had to respect that.
Well, Snarl kind of hits two birds with one stone. You're going to break the Disguise on the Mimikyu, but also hopefully get a special attack drop if you had decided to Dynamax the Celesteela. So I really love this play. I'm curious to see what Rillaboom goes for. If it's a Wood Hammer, it might be enough to take off the KO, but no, it is going to be a U-turn. They're going to let you get up the Trick Room here, and potentially I wonder if they're worried about a Will-O-Wisp going into this slot, or maybe they'll just be prepping for a Trick Room and deciding how to go throughout the game with that. And they seem to have brought out their speed control with Thundurus, which I think is very smart, and also maybe some pressure against Celesteela if there's some physical or special attacking electric type moves on there. Wild Charge or Thunderbolt would be kind of a threat to the Celesteela.
Yeah, so I kind of got bailed out there. I basically just protected. I protected from the Snarl to, like, hopefully not get a special attack drop and just hope I get Trick Room up. And I was able to do that, thankfully. But now they have a Thundurus in, and I still am convinced this thing has Eerie Impulse at this point. And so now I'm just thinking, okay, well, I'm going to max and do as much damage to your Thundurus as possible. I saw a KO last time, so I'm pretty sure it'll KO again. And I'll just click Shadow Claw, and if you try to get fancy, I'll get damage off on something.
Absolutely. And because that's Scary Face, we would imagine this is more of a support set. So if they do elect to do damage into Celesteela, on the good news, you might proc your weakness policy, and you might get more bang for your buck than you know, it's a decent trade depending on how much damage goes into the Celesteela. But are we going to see a Dynamax on their side? We do. I would imagine this is the Thundurus. I would imagine that they have some offensive investment then into their electric type attack. And I'm curious. Oh, I am so mistaken. It is the Spectre that is Dynamaxing here. I was not expecting that at all. That is so fascinating. I'm curious to see if it pays off, considering that I think Snarl would be maybe one of the most consistent things. But no, they go for a Scary Face, lowering their speed within Trick Room. Curious to know if the speed will be low enough to go first, and it is. There should be a one-hit knockout onto the Mimikyu. It is gone. And what an exciting turn. I think that what a great adjustment. I would imagine when they're deciding who to bring in there for that U-turn on the Rillaboom, they've immediately made the plan. Okay, I need a Scary Face myself. It's the only way I can keep going forward and make sure that I don't get destroyed by the slow mons. And this Rockfall is going to be able to pick up the KO since there's no Eerie Impulse or Snarl. So we see these two Pokemon that are Dynamax on either side that have so much power, both of them having plus one special attack boost to them. And I would imagine with that Scary Face onto that Spectre, the Thundurus kind of did its job, and now Spectre might be able to just start taking one-hit knockouts.
Yeah, so like you said, the Spectre is pretty boosted at this point. As soon as I saw the Dynamax animation coming out, I kind of figured that it was going to be a side Scary Face because he had revealed it, or they had revealed it in Game 1. But the Rockfall actually didn't KO their Thundurus. It lived on like 1 or 2. It was a roll. And I didn't get the special attack boost as a result on Celesteela.
Oh, I'm so sorry. I think the frames or whatever maybe missed that. That is unfortunate.
Yeah, so I mean, I'm not boosted here, and so now I'm trying to decide what to do, because I effectively have to stall out my own Trick Room I just set up, because that Spectre is probably faster than everything on my team now at -2, because based on some speed tiers in the game one, I figured I was modest. And so now I'm trying to decide what to do, and I'm thinking, okay, even at +1 Spectre, it's not Life Orb, so it's not going to do too much to Celesteela here. So let me protect Volcarona so I can at least redirect the next turn and try and stall out Trick Room, you know, with some more protects. And then, keep my Celesteela alive. And I just kept telling myself, I was like, just take the kill that's in front of you. Even though it's Airstream and it's going to, like, be bad in Trick Room, just take the kill and take out the Rillaboom. So I decided to Airstream.
Well, that makes a whole lot of sense because, you know, Trick Room is going to be expiring, and I would imagine that Celesteela is going to be around for the late game. Mm-hmm. So it certainly doesn't help, and especially if you're getting a +1 special attack out of it, I don't think it's necessarily a terrible thing to be putting yourself slower than the Spectre, especially considering that you already are slower than it in Trick Room. So might as well go for it. Mm-hmm. And if you're able to, if I've been counting the Pokemon correctly, I would imagine that those speed boosts, or I guess the speed drops, we'll be sticking around on that Spectre for the rest of the game, so you don't have to worry about it being such a quick glass cannon that is going first and just taking knockouts for the rest of this game. So perhaps, I think you're in a good spot.
Yep. And I just saw the Sandstorm chip on the Spectre, so I know I can redirect this turn at least, because it's not goggles. And so, yeah, my plan at this point is just take care of everything on the other side and leave Spectre for last when Trick Room ends, and take it out that way.
That makes total sense. The Azumarill, I'm curious, I think we decided that it was Assault Vest, which means that it can't protect, so you're able to get some free damage in there if you choose to do that. Mm-hmm. Could also Max Guard and just play it really safe, wait for Trick Room to end, and then let Celesteela just kind of go on a frenzy, mm-hmm. as considering that they're down to their last two. As did the last two, it's hard to tell with the top screen. Is it last two or there?
Yep, do they have
the
armor
on the back? Okay, so we know that the Spectre is going to be the slowest thing for the rest of the game, except maybe Azumarill. Azumarill might be even slower. So assuming we just can get through this next turn here. But no, instead of playing defensive, you're going to get Rage Powder. Probably still attacking the Celesteela while you're still in Dynamax. That makes sense. Max Phantasm is surely going to take out the knockout. And we are going to see another boost come on to that Spectre, which might be kind of scary. Defense is going to fall, which means the Azumarill, if it has any physical moves, will be able to do more damage, which could be scary. A +2 Spectre is very menacing as a physical liquidation goes through. Technically +1 with that defense drop, but you're going to fire back with a max Airstream. How much does this do? Is enough for the knockout with the Assault Vest? No, it is not. Azumarill lives quite handily, and so that brings us to quite an interesting endgame.
Yeah, so my Celesteela is actually at -3 defense right there and took about 60% from that Azumarill just to base
Oof.
Azumarill's huge power. So I was like, yeah, that kind of hurt a little bit. And I
I
actually.
totally forgot how many max phantasms there were. There were three.
Exactly.
That makes sense why it did so much damage
I
now.
and I was secretly hoping that the Azumarill was still slower so that Volcarona would go down to a liquidation and potentially burn the Azumarill, and then Celesteela would take the Phantasm a little bit better, I think, at that range.
Totally. Well, here we go down to 2v2. Very exciting. Celestia is definitely the strongest piece we have here, but the reveal of having this poison type, well, they don't know it's a poison type, but excited to see what happens. I think this next turn is incredibly important if you're able to get a KO on either of these mons and get into a 2v1 for either side. I do think the Spectre is putting on so much pressure, and if it's able to survive despite the speed drops, if it's able to survive these hits, it might be able to just go for a move that'll just one hit knockout, and then we can go from there. I think this is probably the most important turn of the game thus far, especially with reading into Protects and the mind games. I think this is a really important turn. We are gonna see a Protect come out. Sogaleo right here. Or not Sogaleo. What is this Pokemon here? I
Silvally.
forget. Sogali, sorry, yes.
Silvally,
So
the V. It's
two
okay.
Protects here.
Doesn't matter.
Shadow Ball going through. We're gonna be protected there. And we're gonna see a liquidation come through. Double protect, leaving you open to more to no protects this following turn, unfortunately.
Yeah, but this is thankfully the last turn of Trick Room. So all of my guys on my side are faster now. You couldn't really see it there with my face blocking it, but yeah, this is the last turn of Trick Room. Trick Room's gonna expire here. And then I should be able to just clean up the game from here.
Totally. I would imagine. Is there anything they can do to stop a double tap into the Spectrier? Or you're gonna spread the damage around? I guess it makes sense. Cover for protect.
Yeah, so I have Crunch tacked onto the Silvally there. So my plan here is I know the Azumarill's Assault Vest. I'm just gonna take it out with Silvally. And then I'm going to flash cannon the Spectre to get as much damage on the Spectre as possible so that Crunch can pick it up. Because at this range, I can only kill or knock out one Pokemon with Spectre.
Totally. I hope the viewers will forgive me for calling Savali a Sogaleo. It has been a while since we've seen a Savali, and I've seen too many Sogaleos recently.
They're
Please
pretty
forgive me.
similar. They're like metal canine looking things.
They look kind of similar. It kind of looks like a baby Sogaleo. Flash cans come out. It's gonna do a lot of damage. I'm actually surprised that the Spectre took it as well as it did. This multi-attack is gonna come out. Is it good enough to be? It is. Azumarill is down, which means that the Spectre really needs to get a knockout here and needs to be able to survive another turn afterwards if it wants to be able to clean up this game two and go to a game three. And sure enough, that is going to be enough with the critical hit. I'm not sure if the critical hit mattered as you go down there. We're going to see another special attack increase. I think that's a either if it's not a +2, it's a +3 now.
Yeah, it is at +3 now. I was secretly thinking if this Crunch doesn't
Your
somehow, if
face.
Crunch doesn't KO here somehow, I feel like I might be able to live the Spectre Shadow Ball. But then I saw it was +3, and I was like, ah, probably not. But here's the
There's no
Crunch.
way it lives this crunch, though. This crunch. Oh, yeah, easy.
Yeah, so.
Spectre goes down to the crunch. Thank goodness that scary face worked out for like two turns, and then all
Exactly.
of a sudden it became a win condition for Angelo.
That's right. Yeah, I when I saw them click the self scary face, I was like, oh no, that looks like trouble. But then I sort of realized down the end, I was thinking, okay, well, I can just stall out Trick Room and then I'm faster. And I have a Silvally in the back with Crunch, so I should be fine. And then it worked out. So there was actually just a bit of post-game analysis there. There was actually a turn where I decided to Airstream the Azumarill. And I should have Steel Spiked instead because the Azumarill had Bounce on it as well. And in that last turn of Trick Room where I double protected, if I clicked Steel Spike and they went for Bounce into Celesteela, it wouldn't have KO'd. But if I clicked did the Airstream play that I did do and they clicked Bounce, I would have lost my Celesteela and probably lost the game.
Oh,
So
wow.
yeah, just some like minor like adjustments there that I probably should have made, but thankfully they didn't click bounce and I won anyways. But yeah, that could have been really scary there.
Do we ever see the Azumarill show off bounce though?
No, was I it, found this out in like post game speaking to them and
got it. Okay, well, to be fair, I don't think although it was a self-vest, so we would assume that it has a lot of attacks at its disposal.
Mm-hmm.
Not knowing, not seeing the bounce yet would make it kind of tough to make that decision, I think. But
and also Aqua Jet was another thing that would have been scary as well, but they didn't have that either.
Oh, wow. Well, I guess that makes sense. If you're not running the Belly Drum set, I feel like Aqua Jet is really does such minimal damage that it would rather just have more coverage for Dynamax slots, especially if you have Liquidation. You probably just want to have good coverage on the Azumarill.
Exactly. Yep.
Well, that was exciting. Super fun getting to see this draft league. I'm really looking forward to the coming weeks as we see more games, especially when people are getting used to seeing how people play, seeing how people adjust, and especially I'm so excited to see how a Celesteela that is trained one way might be a totally different Pokemon in a few weeks versus someone else.
Yeah, definitely. And I'm definitely looking forward to playing in the league continuing on. I will definitely be recording and streaming all my matches, so very, very excited.
Well, a huge shout out to Ducky VGC for playing this game. Did an excellent job. I thought every single turn was pretty close. I think it was a really good set, even though it was a 2-0. And I think that I'm really excited to see what happens in the future of this league for Ducky as well.
Yeah, this league has a lot of strong players, so I'm trying to win it all, but it's going to be very difficult.
Well, especially after doing this, maybe some people will be able to peek into your mind and have an advantage over you for this coming weeks. So we'll have to see how you do.
Yeah, we will. And if you really want to see into my mind, you can go watch this video on my YouTube channel, Angelo Hunter on YouTube.
Plug in.
Yeah, this is on Izzy's channel, but I'll give myself a little plug here. This game is on my YouTube and I stream all my matches at twitch.tv/AngeloHunter. So come check it out.
Fantastic. Thanks for watching for anyone who checked into this. And we'll hopefully catch you next week on Izzy's channel as we cover more of these Rayray Draft League matches.
Thanks, guys. See ya.
Have a good one.
Damn. That was some intense matches we just saw there. All right, so with that, let me show you guys the new power rankings. So this was what we predicted last week. And this is the new power ranking. We have the Solossus supporters first. Big shout outs to Atmosphere, starting strong already, showing why they ended up being second in Season 1. Once again, the San Diego Palkias showing us why they ended up also top 8 in last. Very strong performance from Angelo. So really happy. All Wildfish, as we said, while the ranking was done before the swaps, the trade, they showed it how strong they are in this league. Joe K, amazing VGC player. Tortornado, do not sleep on that mod. It was the MVP for their match. And then after that tough but amazing match for the Mawile Murkrows, taking a big win. As I said, it was tight. When Ally and Atmosphere went for their first seeding, it was neck to neck. It was ended up being differentials. So the fact that both of them ended up with 2-0s, it's actually really, really good. And I think we should expect a lot of amazing things happening. So, and then one of the upsets, as I mentioned, that Johnny upsetting, Johnny getting that win from Sven, Peggy putting it in the top 5. So, I'm really excited to see that. And yeah, let's see how this goes. Now, the scheduling, we have a lot of amazing matches that we're going to be happening. One of the matches I'm really excited to see for next week is the Solossus supporters versus Mawile Murkrows. As I mentioned, that they were number one and number... Solossus supporters were number 2, Mawile Mawile Mercers ended up winning the whole season one. So this is a rematch on week two so soon, because I believe they didn't actually fight in the regular season. So really, really hoping to get you feature that match in our videos. Another match I will also be looking is the new Bark Loud Puppies versus the old Wildfish. Okay, 45 Mice got a little bit unlucky losing last week and having another really tough opponent this week. I hope he kept price higher because I think the matches are a little bit even for both sides. But as I mentioned, Tornadoer kind of like, I believe, going to be a little bit of an annoyance for the new Bark Loud Puppies potentially. But we shall see. And then I think the other match I'm actually really excited is Alolan Akilash matchup. Sven Vinsu Bad at the bottom. I personally think, have the two cutest logos in the entire league. So and they're two really good friends of mine. So looking really forward to seeing what they bring, how they connect, because they are both X1s, right? And as I mentioned, the rules, you top 8 is the one that is going to make it. And then a lot of the rankings also going to be depending on your schedule strength too, besides like win rates. So we're going to be, maybe by week 3, we'll have a very decent eye of how rankings will stabilize and who might have already a head start for playoffs. So really, really excited, guys. Again, thank you for watching, and until next time. Bye!